And now, Elmer Davis.
The air war goes on night and day, with the night raids apparently doing the greater damage. Tonight's attacks on England are described by correspondents as perhaps the most widespread of the war. A raid on London began more than 3 hours ago and is still continuing, but whether any raiders got through or how much damage was done is not yet known. In the course of the day, 6 different swarms of German planes, 100 or 200 at a time, attacked the southeast coast. London had 2 alarms, but only a few of the raiders reached the suburbs and none got to the central part of the city. But the British admit that considerable damage was done in Kent and along the Thames. Last night, the Germans struck at the west coast, bombing Liverpool, Swansea, and Bristol, though without much effect, according to the British story. And as usual, the British struck back. Berlin had an alarm last night, though the Germans say the attackers were driven off before reaching the city. And Munich, Stuttgart, Leipzig, Hanover, Emden, Kassel, and other cities were also raided. Aircraft and munitions factories, oil plants, and power stations were hit, according to the British. The Germans say only residential property. Northern Italy was attacked last night, with the same difference in the two sides' version of the results. Alarms tonight in Switzerland show that the British are on their way to Italy again. And this afternoon, they made heavy attacks on gun emplacements across the Channel. The new Argentine cabinet, as our Buenos Aires correspondent Herbert Clark forecast some days ago, is strongly slanted towards sympathy with the democracies, with former Vice President Roca as Minister of Foreign Affairs and Federico Pinedo, supporter of aid to Britain, as Minister of Finance. R. Walton Moore, counselor of the State Department, said today that the department's investigation had established the strong presumption that the liner Athenia, sunk a year ago tomorrow night with the loss of 100 lives, was sunk by a torpedo. This statement, in a letter to lawyers for some victims of the disaster, controverts by implication the German claim, or one of the German claims, that it was an internal explosion. No opinion has been expressed, however, as to who was responsible for the torpedo. Congress gets to work again tomorrow, and Mr. Rayburn, majority leader in the House, said he expected the conscription bill to pass by Friday. Congress will also be asked to appropriate another $1 billion to pay for the training of the conscripts and the National Guard. The President made 2 dedication speeches today, one for the Chickamauga Dam and the other for the Great Smoky Mountains National Park. In the first speech, he said that the TVA development was an example of a people uniting in a war against waste and insecurity, and that it represents one of our greatest defense assets. At the park, Mr. Roosevelt said that we have grown soft in many ways, and if we are to survive, we cannot stay soft in a world where dangers threaten us. And he added, the men and women of America have never held back, even when it meant personal sacrifice, if it was sacrifice for the common good. He spoke of service to the country as an obligation inherent in citizenship, and said that the greatest attack ever launched against the freedom of the individual is nearer to the Americas than ever before, and that we must prepare to defend our freedom if necessary, and prepare beforehand, because if we wait, it might be too late. The first of these speeches was political in the opinion of Representative Joseph W. Martin, the Republican National Chairman, who asked, I quote, "Who is paying for this political excursion of President Roosevelt? Is the cost of his special train and his staff of aides being charged to the United States Treasury, or, as it should be, to the Democratic National Committee? This is a matter which merits the immediate attention of the Senate Committee for the investigation of campaign expenditures," end quote. And that's the news to this moment.